Hey guys, this is Comic You Know and Comic Frontline, and today I am doing Comic You Know episode 157. And that show where I review all the comics I read this week in one show, and this week we have 23 comics, so it's a pretty average, a little above average week for me. So let's get started. What was worst pick of the week? Then we can go all the way to best pick of the week. So number 23 for me was The Amazing Spider-Man issue 16. Sad to see this book so low this week, but I just didn't really agree with a lot of the story. Most of it is Peter dealing with Jay being in the hospital, and he finds out a way that maybe will bring back Jay to his full health, and has to do with cloning. So now we know where maybe Clone Conspiracy would be coming into this, and how Dead No More might be coming into this, which is clones. And the reason I didn't like this is not because, oh my god, clones again, but yeah, clones again, and not making it as original as I thought it was going to be, but also it just felt very out of character for Peter to say, yeah, clones sounds like a good idea, and let's use this guy who I don't know in his life as this guinea pig to figure out if this is okay for Jay. And that's kind of this whole issue, and I feel like that's really out of character for Peter. Also, not a big fan of the artwork, and I guess we'll see where it goes, but like I said, I just didn't agree with the story. I think some people that do agree with this story are gonna like it more. There's definitely a lot that happens, but I feel like this is gonna be more of a 50-50 issue for people. So for me, I gave this 2 stars. I didn't really enjoy it. So we'll see where Dead No More slash Clones Conspiracy goes in the future. All right, so that's number 23. Now moving on to number 22, I think is another shocking one for you guys, and that is All-Star Batman issue 1. So All-Star Batman, it was a little bit all over the place for me, and I know a lot of people have said this, and I stated this too, you gotta read it more than once. I think that's really the best way to say it, but I will say with the first read, I didn't really enjoy it or feel attached by any means, and I don't know if a second or third read would really do that for me. I'd probably understand the story more, but it's not really an enjoyable story for me. So that's why it is low. Also, not really a Romita Jr. fan. I think his artwork's better here because of the good coloring, but still very bulgy, and the portions are off, and too much line work on the faces. Like I said, it's improved, but still not really my style of artwork for Batman. The part I liked definitely the most was the ending, where we get to see Batman talk about different colors and what it means to the Bat family. I like that. I like Duke's role in this book. But at the same time, I think they're a little bit too mysterious about Duke's role, so you don't really know what he's playing, and it's not really doing anything for me. It's like, oh, mysterious, that's good. But it's not. It's kind of just annoying. Like, all right, just tell us already. What's his name? It's not really holding suspense in any means. It's just kind of annoying, the mystery. But yeah, like I said, it's an okay issue for me personally. We'll see where it goes, but it just wasn't my taste, and it was an expensive book too. So that was number 22, and I gave that 2.5 stars. Moving on to number 21, which is a book that tends to always be this low, and that's All New, All Different Avengers, issue 13, which is a Civil War II tie-in. So this issue should have been called Vision Civil War II tie-in, because this has nothing really to do with All New, All Different Avengers. It just has to do with Vision, and him being able to maybe change the past with King the Conqueror. And it's a lot of inner dialogue with himself saying, oh, if I do this, what would happen? So it's very much in this theme of Civil War II, so I can't say it's not a tie-in, but it's not really an all-new, all-different title. It feels very fillerish in a lot of ways, and it goes back to this book not really knowing what it is, and that's been my biggest problem with all-new, all-different Avengers, especially now we're going into a whole nother direction with the Champions, and it rebooting, I think, with Marvel Now, so, or like imaging itself and reimagining itself. But I gave this 2.5 stars. I'm not a huge Vision fan, so I wasn't very interested in this. And as, you know, Avengers fan, I was just like, oh, I guess this wasn't really an Avengers book or really needed. So I gave that 2.5 stars. Also, the artwork's still mediocre in this book. All right, so that is number 21. So moving on to number 20, which is Van Helsing vs. Frankenstein, issue 1. Now, this book I'm a little disappointed to see so low, because I am a big Pat Shand fan. But I'm not a huge Van Helsing fan, so I can understand why I didn't connect to this as much. And the artwork was very average, a little bit below average with some of the line work. So yeah, I didn't really like the artwork. That kind of took me out of it. It's also a very dialogue heavy issue, so you really have to take your time to read it. And the thing I did like the most about it was definitely Van Helsing dealing with her age and her relationship with her boyfriend. And I thought that was interesting, you know, dating an immortal and then her not being immortal, and then dealing with this whole monster idea of Frankenstein, that now Van Helsing might want to put her soul in another body, which is very Frankenstein and ties into that, and that was fun. The newer characters weren't as interesting to me. I think that's why it is this low, and again, the artwork tends to be why it's this low too. But yeah, I'll pick up the next issue, see where it goes, but I just wasn't attached to this one as much as previous Van Helsing books. So I gave this 2.5 stars, and that is number 20. Moving on to number 19, which is a book I am disappointed to see this low also, and that is Vampirella issue 6. This is the last issue to the miniseries, which I think is the biggest problem, is that this is a miniseries. I think this book should have been ongoing, and if it was just a miniseries, not to have this issue. It wasn't a needed issue, very filler, and I think you should have just ended the miniseries last issue. And I thought this was an ongoing, because like some sites said, oh no, it's continuing, and some sites said, oh no, it's a miniseries. So I was a little confused, and now this makes me worry about Miss Fury actually being a miniseries, which I think it is, and I really like that book. So we'll see when that comes out. I think the next issue is there. It's last issue. I kind of wish that Dynamite did more ongoing series than just miniseries, because I think Bionic Woman also failed with that. It just didn't know how to end its story, and I really liked Bionic Woman's last volume. And Vampirella kind of is the same thing here. This issue wasn't needed. I guess it was a fun thing, but it wasn't fun for me, the issue. So we'll see where Vampirella goes, if we can get an ongoing, or if the miniseries next time is just kind of more contained. So I gave this 2.5 stars. I think that was number 19. Yes, so now we're moving on to number 18, which is lower than I expected, because this was actually one of my most anticipated books for this week, and that was Neverland issue 1 from 451 Media Group, which is definitely underrated comic book company, and I've been loving their comic book Sunflower, which I think has been a little delayed, but hopefully that comes out soon, because that's definitely my favorite book from them. And yeah, Neverland I wanted to try out because I'm a big Disney fan, and I thought it'd be interesting to see another perspective on the Peter Pan fairy tale, and they do that here. It's interesting to see the world that they build, which is kind of like this hipster type thing. It has to do with drugs, and you see how the relationships of Tinkerbell and Peter Pan are very different. I think the reason it's so low, though, is definitely not because they changed so much. I actually thought that was the more interesting part. It's because none of these characters, for me personally, I felt attached to. There was no one that really stuck out that I'm like, oh, I really want to follow this journey, and I care about this new world that this Peter Pan type fantasy is making. I think they focus so much on making it different and edgy that it kind of forgot about the characters and why we would want to continue with the series. Also, the artwork, I like the coloring. I think the colors are really bright, especially in the beginning of the issue. But the artwork's kind of simple, and especially with facial expressions, and I think that could have been better. So, Neverland issue 1 gets 3 stars. I don't know if I'm going to get the next issue. It depends how big the week is when it comes out. Alright, so moving on to number 17, which is Empress issue 5. A book that I want to like more, because I think it has a lot of promise, and the artwork is amazing by, however you pronounce his last name, Stuart Amanunan? 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 Can never pronounce his last name. Anyways, I think his artwork is really beautiful, and that's definitely the greatest part of this book, is because it's so action-heavy, the artwork really does shine through here with facial expressions, and like I said, just in general, good artwork. So artwork's great. Story, on the other hand, it's a very quick read. There's not a lot of dialogue. And also, I feel the characters should be developing a little bit more. We're up to issue 5 already, and I don't really care about the characters as much as I want to. I still think it's interesting. Oh, you know, the kids and the adults are separated here. I like that aspect. I like that the kids kind of save themselves. But And there's definitely some cool scenes of one of the kids, like, building something, but I do want to care about these characters more, and I think we need more character building as we get to the end of this. So, Empress issue 5 gets 3 stars for me. Still, I think is a book worth picking up, but just hasn't been up to the expectations that I want this series to be at. So, we'll see where it goes. I don't know how long this series is, but usually, it's like 8 issues, Millar's stuff, so we'll see. Alright, so moving on to number 16, which is The Accused, issue 1, which is actually a one-shot. I thought it was a mini-series. Sorry that my voice just went somewhere. Anyways, The Accused, issue 1 is a one-shot. I thought it was going to be a mini-series. And I like the book. I don't know if you necessarily need it. It does sell more as a Matt Murdock book than a Clint book. I think if it was in Clint's point of view, it would have been more interesting. But I like that they actually played with the realism of court, that they actually made these Marvel court things up. Like, oh, the House of M caused this for the Supreme Court to make this decision that is now active in law. And I said, that's when I was reading that, I was like, oh, that's kind of cool, you know? So I enjoyed that aspect of the story. Artwork is a little bit too gritty. I think it fit the tone of it, but I personally just didn't really like the colors for the book. But overall, I gave it 3 stars. It's a bit on the expensive side, but if you like Matt or you like Clint, especially if you like Matt Murdock, I think the issue is at least worth reading. So The Accused, issue 1, gets 3 stars. So that was number 16. Moving on to number 15, which is Hal Jordan and the Green Lantern Corps, issue 2. A lot higher than last time. Still not a great book for me personally, but at least it's getting a little higher. And that's mostly because of the artwork. I really like the action here. The book is still pretty predictable to me. It's still Sinestro versus Hal and, you know, the other Corps members trying to just become part of the Green Lantern Corps again and kind of saving themselves. So it's still very generic, and that's why it's kind of in this middle zone of 3 stars, because the artwork's beautiful. I mean, it's kind of interesting, I guess, but still very generic, and I want it to be a little bit more original, because I've seen this a billion times with Green Lantern. So we'll see where it goes. Hal Jordan and the Green Lantern Corps gets 3 stars. Alright, I think we're up to number 14 now. Yes, we are up to number 14, which is Deathstroke Rebirth, issue 1. And I like this book. I don't necessarily think it needed a rebirth issue, though. I think that's my problem with this issue, is like, it's not needed, but I guess it's fun. The artwork's really well done. I really like the deep colors here. Just really well done action, too. So I like that. The main story of, you know, knowing that Deathstroke is an assassin wasn't as interesting, you know, him, like, doing this hunting thing, I just didn't care about. But the aspect I really liked was the family aspect of seeing Slade's 2 sons. I thought it was really cool, and I can't wait to see where that family aspect goes, because I think this series is going to focus more on that than the previous series did, which I actually dropped right before it ended, because I just didn't like it. So I'm hoping that this series will go in a better direction, and I think it will if you focus on Slade's family. It's something that I think is the most interesting about his character. So not a bad issue. Don't know if this needed to, you know, happen as a rebirth issue. Maybe it should just start out as issue 1, but still cool if you don't really know anything about the character. So I gave Deathstroke Rebirth issue 1 3.5 stars. Alright, so now moving on to number 13, which is Birthright, issue 18. Now, I think this issue picked up a little bit than, or the series has picked up a little bit than what it has been doing. It feels like it's been stalling. It's a very slow series. That's the one thing I will say, and I've been saying, Birthright's probably a better trade read than it is issue by issue. It's very slow. It's actually very heavy dialogue also, and the artwork fits for the tone it's going for. It's not my favorite art, but I do like it. I think I've gotten used to it by now. So I like this issue. We get to dig a little bit deeper into kind of the family dynamics between Mikey, his brother, and his father, and a little bit of his grandfather. And it's fighting this demon that's attached to Mikey. Now, my favorite aspect of the story is definitely the mother and Riku's story, where she's having this baby and you don't know what's going to happen because it's half the, you know, Riku's I guess, Heritage and then half Earthling. And you're like, oh, what's going to happen with this baby? And they mention that here. It's like, how is this going to happen? Like, you know, can this baby survive? So that's definitely the aspect I really like the most. And it's the part they don't focus on as much because it's more of this action series, magical series, fantasy series. But I'm really looking forward to when the family's all together. I think that's when the series is going to be at its strongest. So, but this is definitely enjoyable. I like this issue more than I've had in the past. And I always still look forward to Birthright because, again, it is a slow burn, but still an interesting read. So Birthright issue 18 gets 3.5 stars. Moving on to number 12, this is a lot lower than issue 1 was, and that was New Superman issue 2. I still like this book. I love the ending. I like the cliffhanger that definitely made it for me, which is our main character just revealing his secret identity. He's cool with that. That's very much his personality. His personality, I liked more in the first issue. I think he was a little bit more likable there. And I don't know if we need the Justice League. I think that was my biggest problem with the book, is like, it's a little bit too soon for the Justice League. I want to know about this character more. But yeah, there's definitely a lot of interesting plot twists here that make it cool, and I like the artwork, and I'm still very interested to see where the book goes. So, New Superman issue 2 gets 3.5 stars. And that was number 12. Moving on to number 11, which was Spider-Man 2099 issue 13. And this was a good book. I liked it. I don't know if it necessarily needed to tie into Civil War II. That's probably my biggest problem with it. But Roberta, you know, Captain America is 100% the best part of this book and the best part of the series. And the reason why I'm really picking up the series is because of that character. I want to learn more about her. I think she's definitely the most interesting element. Also, we get to see some of the supporting characters here that work with Miguel. I'm glad we're fleshing them out a little bit more. Hopefully, we'll flesh them out even more, but I like where we're seeing them fleshed out. And I thought this was an interesting issue. I like that Roberta's back in 2099, trying to look for her family. Again, best aspect is that character. Civil War II, I could have done without. But I like the issue. Good artwork. Really fits this book well. So I give this issue 3.5 stars. Alright, so I think that was number 11, and we are moving on to number 10, which is Detective Comics issue 938. This is higher than it's been, which I'm happy. I will say it's still very much this action issue where it's Kate and her team versus her father. It's not very story-driven, this issue, but it's character-driven. We get to learn more about Batwoman and her father's relationship in the past, and the relationship they're kind of going with this issue, or with this series. And I really liked how they changed the artwork there. I thought that was cool. That it's like more a throwback to what the artwork looked like previously with the original Detective Comics run. Artwork's still a little plain in facial expressions, but still very good action here. So I like the artwork for the most part, and I think it fits the tone of this book. And I think we got small shining moments with the characters finally again, the supporting characters, not just Kate and Batman and her father. My favorite scene being with Stephanie saving the day and saving Tim, where she does it in such a Stephanie way, where she activates the soldier's bombs, and she's like, yeah, I kind of just did that and see if it worked, and if it didn't, I kind of would have figured it out, right? So it's very Stephanie type way that she saves the day and then has Tim in her arms. I thought that was a cool scene. And also Cassandra being an amazing character. I love what they've been doing with her. Even though obviously she's a very silent character, they do a good job at really showing her emotions through her physical attributes. And that's definitely an aspect I like that they kept in the DC Rebirth error now that we have. So I liked it. I could have used more Clayface. I still think they haven't utilized that character as much, but yeah, the small character moments definitely made it, but I want to see bigger moments in this book because it's a bit of a slower burn. So Detective Comics issue 938 gets 3.5 stars, and that was number 10. Moving on to number 9, which is a book that's a lot higher than usual because it does make a bit of a change in this issue, and that is The Flash issue 4. The artwork changed, thank God, and it's a lot cleaner. Now, I will say there's some proportions that are off, but since the artwork is so much cleaner, you kind of look past it, and the coloring's really bright, and it worked. It really did work, even if, like, Iris looked really small in some scenes, and her head didn't really fit her body at times, but still, I think the artwork improved a lot more. Kind of want to show you that Iris scene if I can find it. Let me see. Yeah, like over here, like for some reason the proportions just looked really off there. She looked a lot shorter than she usually does. And I think it's just the way the panel lined her up. Yeah, it was weird. But the artwork is definitely an improvement here. The colors don't mesh and make it muddy. It looks really cool. So I like the improvement there. Story-wise, I enjoyed it. I like that Flash is trying to train these speedsters. Still trying to figure out who Godspeed is and figure out his role as this leader. And then he tells his crush, you know, hey, I'm Barry Allen. Because he's tired of keeping these secrets and she has the same powers as him. And I like the direction of where that's going. I really like her character too. And I like the newer characters. So Flash issue 4 I thought was a very solid read. Really like that cliffhanger. And hopefully it continues to improve like this. So this is definitely a big improvement for the book. So Flash issue 4 gets 4 stars. Alright, so now we're moving on to, I believe, issue number 8. So number 8 is a book that was very low for the actual book, but the annual being a lot better, and that being All New, All Different Avengers Annual issue 1. Probably one of the best All New, All Different Avengers books I've read. Now, that's not really a contest in any way, but it was original. Now, there's some of the short stories that I'm like, oh, you know, it wasn't as entertaining as I wanted it to be, but like the She-Hulk one, I'm like, why did She-Hulk have a short story? She's not even in this book, so I didn't really understand that. But it was fun. I liked that this whole issue was Kamala reading fan fiction, which is so much her character. And then we learned that one of the romance Miles Morales Kamala stories was actually Miles Morales writing it. And then we find out that the moderator of this whole website is Phil Coulson. I'm like, yes, that is perfect. And that's what made the issue, is the way they tied up all the stories. My favorite story probably being the original one, the first one, which was Kamala wearing this Captain Marvel thing and then making fun of, like, taking up names and mantles. I thought was really cool. And then just saying, oh yeah, of course the guy's going to become the new Captain Marvel, and they just make fun of, like, that whole entire thing, and I liked that. That was definitely my favorite story out of all of them. Also, I guess the last story was interesting too, where we get to see this guy who thinks he's better than Kamala or thinks he's better than Ms. Marvel. I don't remember what they call him or called the story. Let me see. An Evening with Ms. Marvel, A True Story. So those are definitely the two fun ones. She-Hulk one's the one that just didn't make sense, that being there. But this is a solid book, and I think it's definitely worth the $4.99, and is probably one of the best All New, All Different Avengers books I've read in a very long time. So I say pick up the annual before you pick up the actual issue that came out this week. Alright, so that was number 8. Moving on to number 7, which is The Flintstones in issue 2. I've been really impressed with this book, especially the social commentary that this book has been trying to take and succeeding with that. They take religion in this issue. They talk a lot about it in a Flintstones type way. They talk about consumerism, and I think they did a really good job at that. And by the end, actually ties into getting Dino as a pet and saying, because obviously all, and they also tackle why the Flintstones had a pet, and their objects, like a washing machine, was also like a bird or something. And then they mention here that that Dino was, you know, sold as like equipment, and he says, oh yeah, we were gonna, you know, transfer him. He was gonna die pretty much. He's like, and he said, oh, well, what does he do? And he said, nothing. He's like, good. All right, let's take him. Because we get to see the Rubbles have this TV, and so it's cool that we're actually having this modern version of the Flintstones, and then we see the Flintstones have all these different equipment that they don't need, and it's tied into this whole religion thing too, which I thought was a very interesting take on it. So I liked it. I think it's a cool commentary on society in the Stone Age, which is always what Flintstones has been. So they do it in a very modern way, though. It is interesting seeing, what's her name? Pebbles. and Pebbles and Bam Bam's new look. That was cool. They did that in a very, like, I'm a teenage person with angst. she has this weird hair thing. That was funny. So, Flintstones issue 2 gets a solid 4 stars, and I've been pleasantly surprised by this book, and definitely my favorite Hanna-Barbera book. And yes, I'm not reading Future Quest. I mean, that's the reason why, but I like Flintstones. Alright, now we're moving on to number 6. Which is a book I usually don't get because I dropped it, but I kind of just got it because of the cover. And that was All New X-Men issue 2. And I was very surprised by this, and mostly because it was Angel and Wolverine centric. I think Hopeless definitely has the best voice on those two characters. And it was cool just kind of seeing, going into Laura's head about not being want to be touched, trying to be something she's not, you know, trying to be more, I guess, you know, trying to be more with people because she thought that's what Angel wanted, and how Angel also has his own problems because of the Black Vortex and actually dealing with that. And then they get back together in the end, which I really liked, and they make up, and I thought it was a really good story with those two. I will say that the plot itself is not that great, not the character plot, them going to this place and, you know, whatever. Try and defeat these zombie things. I could have lived without that aspect of it, but I know a character returns, so that was cool. But definitely the best part of this issue being Wolverine and Angel. I don't know if I'll get the next issue, but I'm glad I got this as kind of this one-shot thing. Because like I said, I think Hopeless knows those two characters the most out of all the characters on the all-new X-Men team. So that's number 6. Moving on to number 5. You guys are going to be surprised by this. So finally, Action Comics has made the top 5, and it's issue 961. I like this issue because I feel like they slowed down a bit. It wasn't so much about, let's fight Doomsday. It actually delves into those character moments. There's always small character moments in each Action Comics, but here it becomes bigger. You know, Lois having to leave Clark's side and making that a big emotional impact. Lois's relationship with Wonder Woman, Clark's relationship with Wonder Woman. Also, the beginning just kind of highlighting that Superwoman exists, I thought was cool. Artwork, of course, is great. And yeah, I'm glad they just kind of slowed it down a bit with the action and made it more about characters in this issue. So, I liked it. We'll see where it goes. I don't really know what this whole soldier cliffhanger is about, but I like this issue. So Action Comics issue 961 gets 4 stars, and that's number 5. Moving on to number 4, which is another book. Usually this part is in the top 5 and the other part isn't, but Wonder Woman issue 4, which goes into the year 1 stuff. And I personally like this story more than the present story, but they're both good. In their own way. And with this issue, I like definitely the later half. But I also love the lettering. I want to give a shout out to lettering that anytime the Amazons talk their language, you have like this small circle. So instead of doing the little like asterisk type thing that you always see, they made it different. And I really appreciate that as for artwork. So I had to give the shout out to the lettering here. I'm glad they did something different. But yeah, you get to see Steve and Diana connect a little, but they can't totally because they're talking two different languages. And they play with the idea of, you know, Diana going into the games differently. Usually it's her mother saying, oh no, you can't do that. And Diana sneaking in and doing it. But here they play with it differently and actually use a gun as the final final act. And Wonder Woman does the classic, you know, cross her arms, takes the bullet away. And I love that. I thought that was so different and I really enjoyed that aspect. And now it's, we didn't actually see the scene, which I wanted to see, but we get to see now Diana's going to be going into the man's world. And I think this is going to connect even more to, like, what the movie's going to be doing. So I'm excited about this. I really like this. And Nicola Scott's artwork is so good, bringing into this youthfulness of the book. The only, I guess, boring part of this issue, honestly, was the conversations between the other Amazons about this man. I thought that was, you know, a little bit boring for me. But very solid issue. I'm really looking forward to seeing where this part goes and how this connects to the present story. So, Wonder Woman issue 4 gets a solid 4 stars, and that's number 4. There's a lot of 4s there. Alright, moving on to number 3, which has been a really surprising series for me, and that's Red Hood and the Outlaws, issue 1. Still liking this book, and the artwork definitely being one big part of that. I love the coloring that really brings in the tone I feel that fits Jason Todd and his moodiness. I really like it. I really like the art style. Even here with this last page, the art is just so gorgeous for this book. But the story is really well done too. I think Libdell really knows Jason Todd's character, and you really delve into stories that people usually don't delve in with Jason, like his past in this orphanage. I thought that was cool, and how that connects to the present. Now, I will say I still want to see more Bizarro and Artemis. They are doing very slow burn with that, and I hope the next issue will be more Artemis heavy, just to learn more about our character. But I really like this issue, and it makes you care for Jason more, and he's working with Black Mask, and doing this whole Dick Grayson thing, but working. It really works for Jason Todd more because he is the one that kind of is more on that line of good and evil. So I like this issue a lot, and I hope it kind of sticks with this pace. So Red Hood and the Outlaws issue 1 gets a solid 4 stars, and again, I hope that next issue is as good as these first 2 issues have been. Moving on to number 2, a book that I was really surprised with, and that was A-Force issue 8. I wasn't really expecting much from this tie-in. I don't know why. I didn't really think about it. I'm like, oh, cool, you know, Captain Marvel. We've seen her so many times now. But I honestly, this is one of the best tie-ins I've seen, especially with Captain Marvel and dealing with She-Hulk. It deals with a lot of these different personalities that we already know that kind of clash with this team, clashing with Civil War II, which obviously is a big theme for Civil War II, is the clashing personalities and disagreeing with each other. But now it's these teammates disagreeing with each other that Captain Marvel sees, or, you know, hears that Ulysses has this vision about Nico killing this girl named Alice and wanting her to arrest Nico, and Dazzler is not happy about this, saying that you shouldn't do this, and it has this actual argument about She-Hulk not wanting this. She would not want this for any of this. She doesn't want Captain Marvel, at least Dazzler thinks that She-Hulk wouldn't want Captain Marvel to do this, especially her view on the law. So I thought that was really interesting that people haven't really tackled in any other story. So we get to see that side with Dazzler and Singularity just not really knowing what side to take. And it's Captain Marvel actually thinking, am I doing this? Am I doing the right thing here? And then Nico, I loved her reaction saying, I'm gonna run away. You know what that means? It means people I trust betrayed me. And this is betrayal. And you know what that also means? It means people who wanted me to be trapped. And wants me to be trapped and always define me for something I haven't done yet. And that, I just got that just now. It's defining someone for what they haven't done yet, which is always the premise of the Runaways, is that, oh, of course these kids of evil people are gonna be evil, right? And they're like, no, we're gonna do our own destiny. And I loved how they play with that Runaways theme here. And then they add Elsa Bloodstone, which I thought was a really cool team up between Nico and her, because and the metal of their arms, and they're like, oh yeah, Misty Knight too, which was, they actually have a fun scene with Misty Knight and Nico in the hospital. I really like this. I think it plays with the personalities really well. It really shines with that, but it also plays with the theme of Civil War II very well, which is obviously what a tie-in should do. It actually feels like a meaningful tie-in. I will say my only negative is that sometimes the art felt a little dark, but actually the artwork was an improvement. There was some line work that could have been a little better, but yeah, I really enjoyed this issue, and it makes me excited to see where it goes. So I gave A-Force issue 8 4.5 stars. I thought it was a very well done issue, and this is what a Civil War II tie-in should be like. So that's number 2 for me. Moving on to number 1, which is a very obvious number 1 for me, just because I love this issue, and that was Superwoman issue 1. I was blown away by this book when I read it. I love that they tricked us. And it wasn't like, oh no, they tricked us, you know, false advertising. I felt good that they tricked us and that we didn't know what we were getting into. That Lana was really the main star of this book, and that I knew personally that Lana was going to be part of this book, because I remember in The Last Days of Superman, I'm like, they were both zapped. And you could go back to my reviews. I said they were both zapped. She's going to be part of it. And she was. So I called it. But yeah, you know, I like this because first of all, I really like the conflicting personalities of Lana and Lois, but at the same time, them becoming friends. Lois saying, I will not leave your side. And then that cliffhanger of Lois dying, it seems like. I don't think she's dead. I don't think she's actually dead, but I think Lana's gonna think she's dead for a little while. So I just really enjoyed it. I love the action scene with Lex, with the whole boat, and that Lana did not want to be a hero because Clark never really gave her these powers. We find out a little bit about Lana's family, and how that affects her. I like that her powers were different than Lois. I thought that was really cool. I like where her career is going. I like that they mentioned she's a farmer. She's an engineer, and they play with physics very well in this book. But now she's a news reporter, which actually plays a little bit with her pre-New 52 story, if you remember in Supergirl. She was a reporter there, too. I love this book. It was a perfect book for me. I gave it 5 stars. I just can't wait for the next issue. This is the best DC Rebirth book I've read by far, and I just can't wait for the next issue. So 5 stars for me. Love this book. Pick it up if you haven't. This is Comic You Know. Let me know in the comments below what was your worst pick of the week, what was your best pick of the week, and everything in between. This is Comic You Know and Comic Frontline. Don't forget to follow me on Twitter. Don't forget to like my Facebook page. Also, description below, there are links for my comic book, like Father Like Daughter, and don't forget to like the Facebook page of Like Father Like Daughter, and of course next week I'll have another episode of Comic You Know episode, and I will see you guys later. Bye.